think she'd do a great job.
Oh, thank you very much. I appreciate the comment.
Big supporter.
Thank you. You're very kind.
I
I would like to call the June 25th, 2013 Forsyth County Planning Commission meeting to order at 6:33 p.m. Please stand and Commissioner Nolan will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance this evening.
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Agenda not to agenda. Are there any changes to the agenda? If not, I make a motion to adopt the agenda as presented. May I have a second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Nolan. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion passes to adopt the agenda 5-0. Review of meeting procedures. Ms. Goldman, would you please read the meeting procedures?
Welcome to the Forsyth County Planning Commission meeting. We would like to take a few minutes to cover the procedures of the meeting for those of you not familiar with them. For all public hearings, the Planning Commission will allot 10 minutes per side, not 10 minutes per speaker. Please only request to speak if you have something new to add. Please refrain from disrupting the meeting through general outbursts, applause, or comments, and please be courteous of others with the use of cell phones. The public is reminded that addressing the Planning Commission or the Board of Commissioners directly is not allowed. All comments shall be directed to the application being heard by the boards. Anyone wishing to productively contribute is welcome to speak during the respective public hearing. Anyone speaking at the public hearing is required to complete a public hearing sign-in sheet and shall give the public hearing sign-in sheet to staff before approaching the podium. These sheets are available as you enter the meeting room or from our staff. At the podium, please state your name. All information submitted by the applicant or opposition shall be presented to the staff, not tendered directly to the Planning Commission members. Information shall then be distributed to the board members with one copy retained by the Department of Planning and Community Development as part of the permanent record. The Department of Planning and Community Development is open Monday through Friday from 8:30 till 5. Additional information on cases heard tonight can be found on the Forsyth County website. The recommendations of this meeting will be heard at the Board of Commissioners meeting on July 18, 2013.
Thank you. Motion to consider the minutes, adoption of the minutes for the May 28, 2013 regular meeting and June 18, 2013 work session. May I have a motion to adopt the minutes for May?
If I can make an announcement, staff would like to request that you postpone adoption of the meeting minutes from the May meeting. We do need to make some changes based on legal comments.
You need a motion for that? To postpone it or not? Yes?
Yes, I'd like a motion on the May 28th regular meeting.
May I have a motion to postpone the minutes for the May 28th, 2013 regular meeting?
So.
It was a motion by Commissioner Iglesias and a second by Commissioner Moses. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Is there any opposed? Motion passes to postpone the adoption of the minutes of May 28th, 5-0. May I have a motion to adopt the minutes for the June 18th, 2013 work session?
So moved.
Motion by Commissioner Nolan and a second by Commissioner Moses. All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to adopt the minutes for the June 18th, 2013 work session passes 5-0. Are there any announcements? Old business? Public hearing, Michael Clements, CP120006 has been postponed. Withdrawn by the applicant on June 18th, 2013. That's Michael Clements, CP120006. Public hearing conducted on May 28th, 2013. Discussion of the application by the Planning Commission will reconvene only. 88 Davis Creek, LLC.
I'd like to make a motion. I'd like to due to a lot of irregularities with the site plan, which in my opinion does not conform to the UDC, I would like to make a recommendation to deny ZA 3623, 88 Davis Creek, LLC.
Is there a second? Commissioner Moses' motion. Motion dies for lack of a second. I'll take a stab at making the motion. I motion to send ZA 3623, 88 Davis Creek, LLC, to the Board of Commissioners with a recommendation of approval with the following conditions. The property shall be rezoned res 4 with no more than 2.95 tons per acre permitted on the subject property for a total not to exceed 247 homes. At a minimum, homes shall have not less than a two-car enclosed garage. All utilities shall be underground. Exterior lighting fixtures shall be of a type and situated so that light is directed only downward. Fixtures shall be no more than 15 feet high and shall be designed so as to minimize light spillage to not more than 1 foot candle along the boundary of the property. The developer shall use a variety of techniques to avoid the monotonous appearance of identical homes. Such techniques may employ, among others, the use of differing front elevations, architectural styles, building exterior setbacks, and other similar techniques to provide a more pleasing appearance to the subdivision. No final siding shall be allowed. There should be a landscaped entrance with a monument-type sign. Membership in a homeowners association shall be required for the maintenance of the landscaped entrance area. Detached homes shall have not less than 2,200 square feet of heated floor space, exclusive of garages and basements. Outside construction working areas will be restricted to Monday through Friday, not later than 7 p.m., and Saturdays, not later than 6 p.m. No outside work shall be allowed on Sundays. sidewalks shall be provided within the community. Possible engineering conditions, developer shall reserve additional right-of-way for Dave's Creek Drive, road improvements per Forsyth County Ordinance Number 101. No traffic study will be required unless recommended improvements are not incorporated into construction plans. An amenity area shall be provided for this development. And open pavilion area, and the amenity area will be 6% of 83.68 acres. Lots adjoining A1 zoned parcels 154-022 and 154-020 shall have 50-foot buffers and be a minimum of 80 feet in width. That's my motion.
Second.
Discussion.
Is there any discussion?
Tom, can you put the sketch plat under the site plan for the res? So, did you say res that you want to approve it as presented, res 6?
No, res 4 with a density of 2.95, 247 homes.
Res 4.
Res 4, yes, sir. You do realize with what I gave the density, this will be different.
Yeah.
Okay.
But before we have the site plan. Actually, this is for the Red 6, but. I've got the res 4, or the res 4 is out there, and it's exactly the same. The only difference between this site plan and the res 4 site plan is that the res 4 site plan has a res 4 rather than res 6. And then the lots are a little larger. But, I've got several concerns with this. I've tried to find contracting engineers incorporated, secretary's website, secretary of the corporation's website. I can't find it. It's not listed as a corporation. It's my understanding that the UDC right here states under site plans 82E, all applications shall be accompanied and prepared by a registered land surveyor and engineer. So the site plan is to be prepared by a registered land surveyor or engineer. Well, we have no way of knowing anything about the contracting engineers incorporated. Can anybody on this board show me where that particular company is registered as per required by the UDC? Nobody can show me that. Okay. Also, my understanding that when a site plan is presented, it should have a seal a stamp with the registered engineer's number or license number, so that that person can be, or entity can be responsible for what they put up. Can anybody show me the seal with the number or license number for a registered engineer on this site plan? Also, it should have the signature of the registered engineer. Can anybody show me a signature on this site plan? Can anybody show me a date that when this site plan was drawn up or when it was delivered to the planning department? Those are...
Well, it was submitted May 3rd.
What?
It was submitted May 3rd.
Is there a stamp on here saying that? Because normally they stamp it.
Just stamp on the bottom of the copy.
Oh, it's just written on the top.
No, it's a stamp.
For the res 4?
No, res 6.
Res 6, but we're talking about res 4 right now, right?
Correct.
Show me the stamp on the res 4 with a signature and a date.
Well, the planning commission, at their discretion, can do a lower density, which is what I proposed, a lower density.
Okay, now, as I said, the Unified Development Code requires a site plan prepared by a registered engineer. Can you tell me who the registered engineer is who prepared this site plan? I'll be prepared. I can wait all night for an answer if somebody wants to go look. Okay, so there's not a, this doesn't comply with the UDC on that one spot. This drawing could have been prepared by the college kid 10 years ago or more. We don't know. There's no signature, there's no license number on it.
Dr. Moses, did you look at all of the zonings in our book this time to review them as closely as you did this one?
I've looked at some of them, and
because there's some the ones that also don't have the same thing. So I'm just inquiring that
my mother always taught me that.
I haven't researched this, so I'm not putting myself out there. I'm just asking you because
yes, I
there's
have.
Several other ones that don't have a seal or whatever, and I don't know if that's just because when they were submitted, they were
that's something that may be looked into later on.
Yeah, I don't know.
That may be looked into later on. But that doesn't make this right. One more question. I mean, one more study, or two more. What's the license number of the registered engineer, if there is one?
Dr. Moses, I mean no disrespect with what I'm about to say. I just think that we had a public hearing, we have discussed this, we have researched this, we have talked about this, we had the work session, we talked about it. I think that now we just need to vote.
Okay.
On my motion, if my motion passes, it passes. If my motion fails, it fails.
But I'm bringing up something.
I think that we need to just go ahead and go ahead and get the vote taken so that we can do with the other business that the planning commission has before it.
Well, what I'm saying, with all due respect to you, Mr. Chairman, this is something we didn't discuss, and the site plan is not in compliance with the UDC, and I think that the board should be aware of that. I'm sure I've made that point. And if the documents are done on the slide, we must deny.
I think that we'll make note of that fact, and the commissioners can look at this if, in fact, it gets to them, and staff can as well. So, please, everyone who would like to, do you have something?
I would like to speak on topic for you, Bonnie.
Okay, that's fine.
Dr. Moses, I think that the section of the code I'm looking at is the same section you've been referencing, talking about the site plan requirements at a minimum, 10 copies prepared by a registered land surveyor, engineer, etc. Is that the section?
Yes. I'm just trying to find out who the registered land surveyor is, because I can't find, with all due respect, Madam Chairman, I'm not extending this.
No, I understand.
Yeah. And I just wanted to clarify in that I want to sound as if
I was making it simple, but yeah, that's part of that. But it does say that it should be that all applications, and the operative word is shall. It doesn't say may. It said all applications shall be prepared by a registered land surveyor or engineer.
Et cetera, is the thing. And the word I'm putting a lot, I know shall is an important word, and I realize you're focusing a lot on shall. I'm also focusing a lot on et cetera, which in my interpretation, that means we're talking about someone whose day-to-day business is in the type of activity of preparing these types of plans, and I am comfortable with.
Okay, well, I'd like to ask our legal counsel to follow up on what you're saying.
We will, yes.
If this corporation is not registered with the state of Georgia, and that there's no number on here for a registered surveyor, and also I'd like to get your opinion on that, as well as your interpretation of the word shall.
Well, I don't think it's any question. It's the interpretation of the word shall. It is referred to as mandatory. However, given this is the first time I've heard this particular issue, in interpreting this statute and in reviewing the application of the law of this particular document, I would have to review it outside of the 30 seconds of this meeting. It does, the exact wording is, all applications shall be accompanied by 10 copies of a site plan prepared by a registered land surveyor, engineer, etc. And then it doesn't make reference to the seal or signature in this particular section.
Who do we hold accountable for drawing up this site plan?
In what way?
Let's say if something's spelled wrong, or if there's an egregious error on the whole thing, is there any entity or person that's responsible for this site plan? And who is it?
Commissioner Moses, again, I mean no disrespect.
I can't get answers to my questions.
I think that these are questions that will have to be answered at another time, because they really pertain to other things as well as what we're speaking of, apparently with seals and that you're bringing up.
No, you're missing the point.
I think that we need to just go ahead and take a vote. So I'll
make it real simple.
Yeah.
I do not believe this complies with the UDC, because it hasn't. Well, we don't know who prepared it. That's it.
And that's on the record. So it's noted.
Could we amend the motion to have that looked at before the Board of Commissioners votes, just to have legal review that?
I don't know that needs to be a part of the motion. I don't think at this point in time it will certainly be something that is reviewed and information provided to the Board of Commissioners, no matter which way the recommendation is planning council.
I think three of them have listened to this and know that they need to look into it. So I think that's the issue.
What happens if it's determined that this doesn't comply with the UDC? What will happen with our recommendation?
Dr. Moses, I would have to evaluate what the result, in what way, and what aspects of the UDC might have been not in compliance in order to determine what the next step would be.
That the plan is conceptual at this stage, and we know the level of detail required to build the neighborhood. That analysis has not yet been done. So for every application, there's the potential that on a minimal level, there'll be things that won't comply when you get into a very fine detail of talking about obtaining a land disturbance permit and building the neighborhood.
Well, the issue I'm bringing up is not minimal. But that's fine.
Could be. And I'm saying on all applications, I anticipate there'd be some of that.
Okay.
And it's sorted out at the at the permitting stage, when a registered professional is required to put their stamp and seal on the documents. And if there's something about this particular plan that you think is lacking, you have the right, and you did tonight, to make a motion to put it off. And I understand that, and that is a
yeah. And we're on charge to follow the UDC, and nobody's been able to. Now, you didn't tell them to stop, so hang on just a minute, with all due respect. We're charged to follow the UDC, and it sure doesn't look like, if we vote for this motion based on this site plan or the one for Res 4, we're not doing our job and following the UDC.
I believe that if we're right now, the density and everything else is different from either site plan. So as I see it, we're voting on a downzoning without any site plan.
That's correct.
And I've always heard that ignorance is bliss. And you're right. We're voting without knowing what the world we're voting for.
Well,
so keep going, brother. I'm going to be quiet. I made my point.
Thank you,
Doctor. Hopefully you see what I'm trying to say. Do we want to vote for ignorance is bliss, or do we want to follow the UDC?
So the motion on the table is a res for zoning with no more than 247 homes and a density of 2.95 with all the conditions that I read previously. All those in favor, please signify by raising your hand. All those opposed? The vote passes 3-2 with Commissioner Moses and Commissioner Neal opposed, Commissioner Iglesias, Commissioner Nolan, and Commissioner Bowman in favor. New business, public hearing for proposed changes to the Unified Development Code.
Good evening. I'm here tonight to present changes to the Unified Development Code. I will go through these sequentially. The first would be changes in Chapter 6, 8, and 18 involving the administrative variance process. This process would allow a variance request up to 15% that could be processed by planning staff. It would involve maximum building height, building setbacks, buffers to include residential exterior buffer, Georgia 400 buffer, large scale retail buffers related to senior housing products, and side and rear buffers. The cost of an administrative variance request would be comparable with current ZBA fees, and the application requirements would also apply as they do for ZBA. Considerations for a decision would follow current ZBA standards, and any administrative variance decision may be appealed before the ZBA. We are also looking to change the variance expiration period. I do want to make a note here. Currently in your draft, it does state that this period would be in perpetuity, but staff, based on a work session discussion last week, staff did present some alternative language based on some member concerns. If we could show that language now, This would be language that the commission can consider this evening, and if you so choose, of course, you could amend the current draft language and insert this instead regarding the expiration period for variances. And as you can see, this is when a variance could be in perpetuity except under certain conditions, such as rezoning of the property or a change of use and so forth, where a variance might need to expire. I'll continue to move on. The second, the third item would be permit expiration periods. And we're essentially looking to double a number of these. One would be the land disturbance permit. Once one is applied for and it's been approved, it would need to be issued within 12 months. Currently, we have 6 months. And then for road construction and site development permits, once they're issued, they currently expire in 12 months. The proposal is to extend that to 24-month period. And then for clearing and grading, they currently expire in 6 months, and we're suggesting that that be doubled to 12 months. We also have building separation changes in Chapter 10, and that's to allow encroachments that we now allow in setbacks for items such as gutters, overhangs, sills, cornices, chimneys, etc., and to also allow that encroachment for building separation in addition to setbacks. Those changes represent discussions that were had in the chamber in the past in terms of reforming our processes and making them more user-friendly. The last item in the list was requested by the Board of Commissioners looking at our residential district performance standards for Res 3 and Res 4, and specifically looking at the minimum lot size requirements, maximum density, and minimum heated floor area. That represents all the changes before you this evening. You can certainly choose to make a recommendation to the board based on our current calendar. This will be heard by the Board of Commissioners on July 2nd. Thank you.
Thank you. I make a motion to open the public hearing for the proposed changes to the Unified Development Code. May I have a second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Neal. All in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to open the public hearing passes 5-0. Is there anyone who wishes to speak in favor of the proposed changes to the Unified Development Code? Is there anyone who wishes to speak in opposition? I make a motion to close the public hearing. May I have a second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Nolan to close the public hearing.
You.
All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to close the public hearing passes 5-0.
Discussion.
Is there any discussion? I suggest that we have three individual motions for these, since two of them were talked about in our work session and Ms. Goldstein referred to them. Some of us may want to add language, etc. So I suggest we have one for motions, one motion for A, C, and D, and a motion for B, and a third motion for E. Is that acceptable to the board?
Are we going to discuss them? I guess we'll discuss each of those three individually as well.
Individually as well, yeah. I think would be best. Since A is...
Wouldn't you just say we're going to discuss which three individually?
When we make the motions.
There's one.
Oh, for the three together. Okay.
And like right now, we discussed the three together. And then
Okay, so we're just voting on, how do we vote on?
Well, we're not voting on it, we're just, that's, we're gonna.
I'm voting, yeah.
So I make a motion to send item A, administrative variance process, chapter 6, 8, and 18. Item C, permit expiration period, chapter 7. And item D, building separation, chapter 10, to the Board of Commissioners with the recommendation of approval as presented by staff in our planning commission books. Again, that. Commissioner Iglesias is the second. Is there any discussion? No discussion on the motion? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion passes 5-0. Now we need a motion on item B, variance expiration period, chapter 8.
Item B, make a motion that we approve the suggested changes to the variance expiration period, chapter 8, or, to recommend approval of, not to approve. With the following change, in section 8.6.4D, strike in perpetuity, which is at the end of the paragraph, and add and replace that with administrative review, zoning board of appeals, planning commissioner, or board of commissioner approval of a variance application shall be valid in perpetuity, except that if a variance was approved as a part of and simultaneous to a rezoning or conditional use permit approval, then the variance shall terminate upon a change of zoning, upon a change of zoning conditions negating the basis for the variance, or upon a determination by the department that the property is being used in a manner different than that of the use authorized by the conditional use permit.
Second.
Is there any discussion? All those in favor of the motion that Commissioner Neal made, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion passes 5-0 to send item B, variance expiration period dash chapter 8. On. Now may I have a motion for E, residential district performance standards, chapter 11.
I don't Did you, I was listening, but I don't know if I heard it properly, on res four, did you say four units per acre?
I said keeping it as it is now, which is over.
We have a motion, do we have a second?
Second.
All those in favor of the motion, please signal. Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay.
I'm sorry, moving way too fast. Is there any discussion on the performance standards on the motion that Commissioner?
Just to follow up, I've got one item I just wanted to, with all due respect, earlier you tried to limit what I was trying to say, that I think I should at least be accorded 10 minutes. I don't think it's right, if you disagree with what I'm saying, to limit what I'm saying.
Are you speaking about the performance standards?
No, I'm speaking of what I'm speaking to the point where you forgot to ask for discussion. And I'm just speaking to that point that I don't think that board members should be limited in their discussion. And I appreciate what you had to say, and I appreciate what you were trying to accomplish, but I was just expressing my opinion, which I do a lot.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you very much. Do you have more discussion? You'd like to discuss the performance standards?
I was just going to mention that part of the reason for this was an idea that I think didn't come from one individual on the Planning Commission, but it had been discussed in work session. And I think that it makes a lot of sense. You know, there's a lot of res, if we were talking about change of performance standards where res 3 is 2.2 and res 2 is 2, then there's not really much difference in what res 2 and res 2.2 is. So this gives an opportunity, and Dr. Moses also had credit him to a lot of this because he's made a lot of good suggestions on it. Talked about trying to make res 2 a more usable zoning if concern that we originally heard was that a lot of the res 3 and res 4 zoning applications actually could fit into res 2 with some small changes because res 2 is essentially not being used as a district. But this does provide a little bit more variation in or flexibility as far as what can be done in what land use categories. And I also believe Vanessa has talked with us in the work session and said that it did not appear, or I think staff in general discussed this in the work session, that this did not appear to be anything that would change the actual character of those uses. So that was the purpose for those suggestions.
I guess I will weigh in a little on this. On the res 2, right now, res 2 is a minimum heated floor area per dwelling unit of 1,000 square feet. The motion proposes to change it to 2,400 square feet. I would like to see what the board members think. Is that proper to make it that large? I know that I don't particularly have a problem with it, but I just think it's something that we might want to discuss. And I may even ask Vanessa, does that seem a little high, Vanessa? Or does that seem reasonable?
The discussion with the minimum heated floor is something that the board was interested in raising, but if you do notice that the draft in front of you does have a note, if not part of a major subdivision, we do keep it to its current level.
I understand that, but my question to you is if it is in a major subdivision, does 2,400 seem reasonable, or are we overstepping what we should do? I'm not trying to put you on the spot. I can ask I just want to make sure we did the right thing.
I don't think I can give you a yes or no. I can offer a couple of points. One is that we typically see product going out that size or larger. So it's not significantly different from what we're permitting down in my office day to day. On the other hand, you're talking about more than doubling the current standard.
Yeah.
So it's a significant change. And it's a change for the few projects that are coming in below average. But on average, it's very close to what we permit for an average home size in the department. Finer than that, I think the Planning Commission needs to make a call on the numbers at that point.
What do you think about that, Madam Chair?
I think that the number, the 2,400 square feet is a big number.
How about
because
you?
Because you have a lot size of 14,500.
How about you?
I think you will find it economically difficult for a developer to build 1,000 square foot home in a res too. So I think that's way too small a house.
Would you like to weigh on, in on it? I'm sorry.
I think it's fine.
2,400 is fine. Obviously, you think so. Okay. I just wanted to make sure because it is, as our planning director said, a significant change.
And I thank you for bringing that up at the work session, the 2.2 and res 2, because I think that will make a difference. I think that was a really good call and a good suggestion.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Are we ready to vote now?
Madam Chair, if my notes are correct, I don't believe we had a second on that motion yet.
Yeah, Commissioner Nolan did.
Thank you, just making sure.
Please.
So we're ready to vote, is that correct? You all are all okay over there? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion passes 4-1 with Commissioner Iglesias being opposed and Commissioner Nolan, Bowman, Neal, and Moses in favor. That takes care of all the UDC changes, correct?
Yes.
Public hearings for conditional use permits. Grace Fellowship of South Forsyth, Inc., CP130003.
Request to seek approval for a worship facility with accessory uses for a daycare and school associated with a worship facility on 7.42 acres of property, currently zoned agricultural A1, with 88,000 square feet of total building area with 263 parking spaces. Variance to the 5,000 foot sewer distance requirement per UDC Chapter 18-5.18. This property is located at 2750 Ronald Reagan Boulevard. Motion staff supportive.
I make a motion to open the public hearing on CP130003, Grace Fellowship of South Forsyth, Inc. May I have a second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Neal. All those in favor of opening the public hearing, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to open the public hearing passes 5-0. Is there anyone who wishes to speak in favor of CP130003?
Good evening, Madam Chair. Commission Ethan Underwood. I'm here on behalf of Grace Fellowship, South Forsyth Incorporated. Fairly simple application. They have a piece of property that's located on Ronald Reagan Boulevard. There we go. It's a little under 7.5 acres. It's currently zoned agricultural. We're asking for a conditional use permit for the church. Because we used the potential school and daycare. We did file for a variance application, but since we filed the application, we got a determination from the Water and Sewer Department that we are not within 5,000 feet of gravity sewer, so we don't have to have the variance. So we're happy to make any recommendation on that. This shows the property. It's just to the west of the Lafarge Mine, just off the screen. You can see Highway 400 up in the northwest corner. It's highlighted in blue, 2 tracks, 7.5 acres. And this shows our site plan. With me, I have tonight Mr. Kevin Hauser and Jack Waltz and Richard Breedlove. We're happy to answer any technical questions that you have, and we'll reserve the matter for now.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who'd like to speak in favor? Is there anyone who would like to speak in opposition of CP130003? I make a motion to close the public hearing. May I have a second?
Second.
Commissioner Neal gave that second. Is there any discussion about closing the public hearing? If not, all in favor of closing the public hearing, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to close the public hearing passes 5-0. Commissioner Nolan, this is District 3.
Madam Chairman, I make a motion to suggest approval of CP130003 to the Board of Commissioners.
May I have a second?
Second.
Commissioner Iglesias made that second. All those in favor, is there any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. All those opposed? Motion passes 5-0.
Thank you.
Public hearings for home occupation permits, there are none. Public hearings for rezonings. Rich Stables, ZA3604.
Request to rezone from agricultural A1 and single family residential S2 to agricultural A1 with a conditional use permit, 16.30 acres for a commercial horse stable with 2,350 square feet of commercial area with two parking spaces. A variance to eliminate the 25-foot side and rear buffer per UDC Chapter 15-1.3, Table 15.2. This property is located on the west side of Concord Road, approximately 650 feet northeast of the intersection with Purple Place, and on the east side of Riley Road, approximately 700 feet north of the intersection with Purple Place. Staff is supportive with conditions.
Make a motion to open the public hearing on ZA3604 Brecht Stables. May I have a second?
Second.
Commissioner Nolan gave that second. Is there any discussion on opening the public hearing? All those in favor of the motion to open the public hearing, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to open the public hearing passes 5-0. Is there anyone who'd like to speak in favor of ZA3604 Brecht Stable? Am I saying that correctly, Mr. Underwood?
Yes, ma'am. Good evening, Ethan Underwood on behalf of Brecht Stables. We're here tonight to request a zoning and conditional use permit for a commercial stable. The property is currently zoned in large part res-2. It was zoned prior before the market crash. Unfortunately, it was not developed, but fortunately for our client, they found a good use that fits in with the area. What we're asking to do is take all of the track, the components A1 and res-2 to A1 with similar conditions and a conditional use permit. It's a total of 16 and a half acres. And we've asked for a variance to a buffer. Under the agricultural code, it states that whenever you go to a commercial use in an agricultural tract, you put a buffer around the perimeter. And we are asking for a variance to that buffer. However, we have been in discussions with an adjoining property owner who wants to preserve at least a portion of that buffer, so we're happy to work with them. And we started to discuss that a bit. I believe that you're also concerned with their concerns. The property is located, has frontage on both Riley Road and Concord Road. Concord Road has several existing commercial stables, so this certainly won't be out of place. It's a large track, you can see the riding rim up in the northeast portion of the property. One of the issues that has become I guess a matter of dispute with the neighbor is that the access has been off of Riley Road. As you can see, Riley Road does have a bit of a residential feel to it. Most of those are 21 to 2 acres, maybe a little larger. And the concern has been that the commercial traffic is coming through there. This shows the site plan that we're proposing. It's a little different than what was originally filed because one of the requests was please don't access off the Riley Road. We are comfortable with that as submitted a zoning condition to require that all commercial traffic comes through the Pumpkin Road. The issues that particularly arisen have been in this area. The bushes are the adjoining property owners that we own. And this shows the particular issues. There is an existing storage building. It's an old mobile storage building. It's located right on the property line. And there is an old storage building that's been there actually since the current property owner purchased the property. There is a home, there's a tenant who operates the commercial stable that lives on the property. And we're asking if we have a continued use the stable. It's a three-stall stable for a barn for horses. But most of the horses actually stay out of the pasture. Again, this is the area that we're proposing to move the commercial use to so that it's not offending the bushes and it's not having noise and light and invasions on the privacy. What we're proposing is to pour a gravel drive There is already a gate on Concord Road, so that can be utilized just to be cleared off a little bit so it can be accessible. But the user actually does a lot of therapy. Therapeutic riding works with special needs children, so it's important that this be handicap accessible. This shows the property line. In fact, you can see the stake, like the green stake between the bushes and property to the north, and to Breck's property to the south. There's large Leland cypresses that are located on the property. Walking around the property on that narrow strip, it's a little difficult to see this lighting. But there is a fence that's already there, and this is the building that we were discussing. It's the hay is being stored in. Walking around further, we've been requested to add an additional fence. Our understanding is the bushes have a horse of their own, and that you don't want other horses that are being commercially boarded to come in contact because of the mass diseases. We have agreed to move this fence back further, so there's between 10 and 15 feet, minimum 10 feet separation between the electric fence and the bushes fence, so there's no equine contact. This is, the lighting, I don't know if we can dim it or not, it's difficult to see. But what's shown is the top of the Bush's house. Their lot slopes up, so you actually have to go to the back of the property to be able to see the horses that are being, and commercial use of the property being put to. So we feel that this provides an adequate separation. Again, here's a view looking down that property line. This is the view from the top of the hill. So if the Bushes were to come up to the top of the hill and look down, this is what they would see. We have the riding ring. And a pole barn that's already there, so it's certainly made for folks to be able to relocate the commercial use. And I actually went last week when there was a summer camp being conducted with special needs children. So this is what you can expect. You can expect a group of about this size, no offensive lights, no offensive sounds. And this again shows horses, the parent, approximately 16 horses on the property now. We'd like to be able to maintain that. In discussing this, we have not settled completely with the Bush attorney. I believe he's here. I can speak on their behalf. But these are some conditions I think that we're very close. What we are willing to agree is that there'll be no access off Riley Road that has to come off Concord Road, and that the stable has to maintain its standing. We do have to have a commercial stable license for the park back and forth. We're comfortable to make that requirement. Again, the horses have to be maintained in accordance with all state and local requirements. We have requested, there is a 25-foot buffer that's required to ask the variance to. We're requesting around the Bush's property line on the southern side to reduce that to a 15-foot planted buffer, simply because the way the buffer standards work is you plant shrubs and then medium-range trees and then overstory trees. So the shrubs that are taking up the front 10 feet of the buffer, no one's really going to see it. They don't provide much sound barrier. And it really, we have to be careful of what types of trees and shrubs we put next to the barn because horses will weaken when it's in. So we think the 15-foot buffer, if it can be more densely planted, will provide a better strength and barrier. Again, we have been asked to install a fence. opaque fence has been placed along that property line with the bushes. There are some repairs, there's some missing slats that need to be fixed up, and we're happy to agree to do that. Number six discusses the agricultural barrier, that's the electric fence that we've shown. Hours of operation were agreed to limit those to daylight hours. Obviously, that varies during the time of year. Limiting light spillage to 1 foot candle on the property line. Number nine, agreed that manure will not be, or any other type of compost will not be heated up to cause the nuisance of flies or smells. And finally, signage. We were agreed to locate signage on the compilation commercial signage on the Parker roadside. This one, we had hoped to have the name of the farm, but if that's going to be confusing commercial signage, we're willing to give it up. That's a confusing issue. Long story short, we have submitted several letters of support from the joint property owners. The only folks that we know of course, we probably would surprise the public here, the only folks that we know of that had an issue are the bushes, and we understand their concerns. But there was a previous tenant there that we understand was doing metal grinding in the middle of the night and was not considered. We understand that with the current operations, there have been some situations where people were parking on the Riley roadside. I wouldn't like it. You wouldn't like to have light shining on your property. We agree, and we're looking to make amends and conditions so that that doesn't happen. So we're happy to continue working with the bushes to make sure they maintain their privacy, and we're hoping that the board will recommend approval for this commercial statement. If you have any questions, we're happy to answer them.
Thank you.
I've
got one question.
Yes, sir.
Excuse me. This is a commercial enterprise, right?
Yes, sir.
Do they pay taxes and for something for business?
There has to be a business license that would be obtained, and then also the property owner who leases the land to the Great Stables, they stop the taxes.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Is there anyone else who would like to speak in favor? Have you filled out your form?
Yes, ma'am.
Please state your name first.
My name is Mel Martin. I live at 6620 Radio. My land touches on the same property. And I'm here in favor of Greg Farmers or Greg Stables. Just to support you.
Thank you.
I'm Mr. President. If it verifies our property is actually on the other side of the bush farm. So it's
your last name was Martin?
Yes, I'm sorry.
Thank you. Anyone else who'd like to speak in favor? No. Please step forward. Did you fill your form out?
You don't have that.
There's a form right on the corner of, right there. Is there anyone else who's filled their form out who would like to speak in favor? Okay, we'll wait.
And she's been doing lessons with the right here, and she's making tremendous progress with the field.
Thank you very much. Anyone else want to speak in favor? Is there anyone who wishes to speak in opposition?
That's located immediately next to the existing stables. As you can see up here on the screen in front of you, that this is the view of the subject property that's subject to the application for the rezoning and CUP from my client's property. The Bushes have lived there for 24 years and never had a problem with privacy issues until the stables turned to its current commercial use. They live on 2 acres of land that's on A1. They don't have any sort of commercial use on their property. Their property is identified as tax parcel number 164015. Currently, the property that's subject to this application is operating illegally under the UDC. They have their existing commercial use ongoing at the time that they're filing for this application to rezone. So as a consequence, my clients are forced into the position of believing that they really have no way to place confidence in discussions with the applicants because if the applicants aren't complying with the UDC as it's currently phrased, how could they expect the applicants to comply with conditions or restrictions on the CUP once it's granted for commercial use? It's not just a therapeutic riding stables right now. They're operating as a commercial stables already without having the proper zoning. And now they've come in without disclosing that in their application. They advertise for sales of equestrian goods on the internet. It's no secret. You can just log on and Google them and find that they're operating commercially. This is causing a problem for my clients currently. This is not a situation where you have neighbors that are fearful of what's going to come afterwards, such as the prior applications that you've been presented with, where neighbors are afraid that if you rezone something for a higher density use, that it's going to somehow affect them in the future. In this situation, my clients are currently being affected by the current manner of operation of the stables. The barn is 50 feet off the property line. It has 3 stalls, according to Mr. Underwood. Currently, my clients have counted 17 horses that are being boarded there. The Georgia Department of Agricultural Permit certificate for this agricultural property lists 7 horses. Violation. The trailer is currently parked by the barn between the barn that you see on the pictures. And Mr. Brown, if you could just start scrolling through the pictures, I'll continue talking so we can make maximum use of the time. The trailer is parked beside the barn between my client's house and the stables. The people that come to watch their children ride their horses park outside of my client's property. My clients are affected by dust, noise, odors, traffic beside their house from the current access from Riley Road and lights. Now they propose a condition that they will access it off Concord Road, but the current use is illegal, so how can my clients be confident that any such condition will be complied with? There's parking on the property line. Manure accumulates on the property, causing smells a short distance from my client's property, due to the number of horses that are being boarded there. My clients cannot get code enforcement to take action because code enforcement says they have to see dollar bills changing hands before they consider it to be a commercial use. Of course, that's difficult to do, but you could look on the internet and see that advertising is taking place. There are no bathrooms for all these residents that are there. The current bathroom facilities are within the house that's on this agricultural property next to the barn. They propose only 2 parking spaces where they have 17 horses and multiple children to attend classes. How can these parents park on the property? There's no provision for construction of the new stables. Mr. Underwood showed a nice site plan showing a new access off of Concord Road, but the barn is still next to my client's property. So that's where the horses are going to be kept for the commercial use. My clients are opposed to any buffer reduction. That is the reason the UDC has the buffer provision in it between commercial CUPs and adjacent residential properties. My clients would request that if there is a zoning that is in opposition to their request, that it be just denied outright, that the Planning Commission adopt or recommend specific hours of operation. Daylight hours is something that's a vague type of provision where it ends, you know, daylight in summertime means it could go on until 9:30 at night. Just want to state quickly that I know the applicant has submitted their constitutional objections just for the purposes of the record. My clients oppose the grant of the CUP and the zoning of the due process, equal protection clauses, and takings provisions of the Georgia Constitution. The advocates that have supported the application and all the letters that have come before you are not from people that are immediately next door to the use. You've heard from people that have their children out there. My clients are in favor of the therapeutic use of the property and wish that it would continue. If it didn't continue, there are other operations and facilities in the county. I know of one that's next to the Chattahoochee River Club that provide the same sort of benefit to residents. We have supplied a list of conditions that we would request be adopted. In considering the application, if the Planning Commission recommends approval to the Board of Commissioners, my clients would request that their conditions, the way their conditions are phrased, be adopted, because they're phrased in a certain way to help them enforce this if it's granted. One other issue, they say they don't want to plant a buffer because they're afraid the horses will eat it. I'm sure that there are plants that they could plant that the horses would not eat, so we think that there should be the planted buffer. And we'll allow some other time for some other people to speak. We requestfully respect that you deny the application.
Can I ask you one question?
Sure.
How many complaints have been filed with the planning department?
I don't know if my clients have filed any type of formal complaints.
Well, but yeah.
A question. I mentioned that there were no adjoining property owners that had made a statement. I thought that one of the ones that made a statement of support was the adjoiner to the south of the.
They're on the other side of the property, the stables, the entrance. Okay. If you see that picture, the current entrance actually runs on the bush side of the property. So when all these trailers are coming in without any type of restriction currently, they basically come right next door to them. And because of the entrance is currently off Raleigh Road, what that leads to is that when people come through, they're parking their rigs on the side of the bush property, they're taking up residence there, and you know that's where the horses are accessed from. So I understand that the neighbors on the other side might not have an issue with it. We don't believe that they're similarly affected.
Continuing on my question about the complaint, you said that the code enforcement people said they had to know that money was exchanged, or you know that it was a commercial establishment. But so y'all have your clients contacted the planning department and tried to.
They talked to them informally.
Informally. Why haven't they filed a formal complaint?
I think that they just exercise their discretion not to take it to a formal level.
Did you have a list of conditions that you were seeking?
We do have a list. We have provided it to the Planning Commission. I can read them out to you if you'd like to hear them.
I was asking.
Yeah, we do have a list. Yeah, we still oppose it, but if you're going to do it, at least condition it with.
Okay.
Commissioner Nagel has the last pick. Thank you, Mr. T. Is there anyone else who'd like to speak in opposition?
My name is Elise Myers. I oppose the application as well, but I'm going to speak to and kind of make this brief. I'm going to speak to assuming that we might pass it, and if that's the case, just have a few things to ask for in passing it, and that would be, one, some of these conditions that Mr. Everwood proposed tonight are not specific enough. I know the manure thing just says that we're going to store it in a place that it's not offensive to the neighbors. I don't think that's going to cause, I don't think that's going to make a solution for anybody. I did a little research and found that the University of Georgia's College of Agriculture estimates that 1,000-pound horse makes about, and I'm sorry, I have to jump right into this, 45-50 pounds of manure a day. She has 16. That is 131.5 tons of manure a year. That's a dump truck, a commercial dump truck and a half every month. So where exactly are we going to store this stuff? When is it going to be hauled off? Where is it going to be stored until it's hauled off? What are we going to do with it? I know as the conditions are written now, there's no composting. Where's it going to go? How are we going to make sure that that's not offensive? Two, I think we should limit the horses that are over there. 16 is too much. Again, the College of Agriculture, UGA, says a good rule of thumb is 1.5 to 2 acres per horse. She has about 16 acres and about 16 horses at this point. That's just far too many. Limit the hours, Mr. Underwood's proposed conditions say it's limited to, the commercial riding is limited to daylight hours. What about non-daylight hours? What about not riding? I'm making noise just fine right here without sitting on the back of a horse. She does, she has 10 boarders right now, which means there's approximately 10 owners that come in there every day, if not more than twice a day. I'm just guessing that that's a rough estimate when you own a horse and it's being boarded. But there's that, there's therapeutic riding lessons, there's therapeutic camps, there's Special Olympic preparation, there are field trips, Western riding lessons, Western camps, and lessons and camps for all ages. That's a lot of people coming and going. So what happens when we're preparing to go to a meet on Saturday morning? Are we loading up a horse trailer at 4 o'clock in the morning? That's not riding, it's loading, but it's still making noise, it's still in the barn, it's still very close to the Bush's house. And finally, I think it's justified to grant the Bush's the fence, full length of the property and all their adjoining areas, which is what they had asked for, and the buffers that they asked for, and to move the buildings. I know now Mr. Underwood sent an email today that says one of the buildings that they don't want to move is actually being used to store hay. I believe that's a fire hazard. It's very close to the Bush's property. In fact, it's right on top of the fence. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sorry, could you tell me where you're located in? Are you in proximity of this property?
They're my parents.
Oh, okay.
So I lived there for, I don't even know, 18 years.
Okay.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else who'd like to speak in opposition? State your name first, please.
Madam Chair, members, I am Kirk Winterstein. I live in Forsyth County. I speak in opposition. I'd like to address this letters of support. I ask myself, why would somebody write a letter of support? Well, they may be nice people. They may, the people on the stable may be very popular on that street. They may go to church together. They may play cards together. They may have came down to my house a few times and pulled a truck or a car out of my back door that was stuck in mud. They may live far enough away where they're not going to suffer a negative impact from the living. The point I want to make is there are dozens of reasons why someone would write a letter of support. I do believe what the prior speakers have said. I'm out of time. Thank you, Madam Chair. I speak in opposition. Members.
Thank you.
I'd like to ask Mr. Underwood a question or two.
Dr. Rogers, I'm happy to. I think I have about a minute 20 for rebuttal, if I could use that. Is that correct?
Well, if he's just asking questions, I won't time.
That's fine. So would you like to go ahead and respond to some of the statements that made?
Let me ask a couple of questions first, and then I'll let you incorporate that.
Okay.
How many horses did you say were there?
There are currently 16 horses, and like the pictures that were shown, many of Mr. Teague's arguments are about 6 months old. The fence that has been constructed along where you were seeing the headlights, there's now an opaque fence that is constructed and standing there. There's still a little touch-up that needs to be done on that. But also the commercial license has been updated to facilitate 16 horses with the State Department of Agriculture.
Are they operating outside of the rules and regulations of the planning department right now?
This was originally, yes. Well, not right now. When it was first filed, this zoning...
In the past, have they been operating outside?
This zoning was instituted based upon a complaint, and code enforcement said that you don't have the proper permits. Following precedent, the planning department said, file your application, we'll work with you so it just doesn't destroy you economically and shut you down while you're going through the long zoning process.
Why didn't they, on their own, come into compliance rather than wait for a complaint to be filed?
Well, I think a lot of it has to do with ignorance. Now, ignorance is not an excuse. Ignorance of the law is not an excuse, but a lot of folks just didn't realize that there was a conditional use permit. So it was operating before the cut.
We believe in ignorance up here.
In any case, sir, it was operating without a conditional use permit. We're here to cure that. And we understand the Bush's complaints. The photos you saw were all dated, and they showed October, November. A lot's changed. We're trying to work with them and accommodate their privacy. We certainly agree they're entitled to that.
Thank you.
Any other questions? If I may, in discussion, we are going to have to, if this is approved, our clients are going to have to comply with all regulations. Health department, as far as toiletries, they can use a temporary toilet for up to 1 year on the site, but they will have to make some type of improvement for septic. As far as the supporters, I wish we could show back on the screen. We do have Coach Bishop on the backside who is recommended, who is supported. We have the Martins came and spoke. Also adjoining the barn to the south, we have a letter of support from the Lanes. So this is not just clients and folks who are coming up there. These are folks who are really going to be affected by the application, and they see the good work that's going on, and that's that. As far as horses, if you look in your UDC, Chapter 16 of our UDC recommends one horse per acre. So with 16 horses, 16 and a half acres, we're certainly coming in what is recommended on the county level. In a rezone, this is an agricultural. So we feel that we're complying. We understand the Bush's frustration. But a lot of the things that they've complained about has been remedied. We'll continue to work with them to remedy. And we're happy to continue to work with them between now and the Board of Commissioners to reach some agreement.
Thank you, Mr. Rumpel.
Thank you.
Questions?
Yes, sir.
Question for staff.
It's noted that there's a limit of one horse per acre for res one. Does that apply on agricultural property as well? Or is that for that particular zoning?
Just a minute, I will have to look in the UDC.
Yes, sir.
Let me verify. Chapter 16, our standard only applies to rest one.
I'm curious, would they be amenable Would the applicant be amenable to meeting that same condition on this property of 1 per acre as it is in res 1?
We would be.
Okay.
I make a motion to close the public hearing on ZA3604 Bridge Stables. May I have a second?
Second.
Commissioner Iglesias gave the second. Close the public hearing. Is there any discussion about closing the public hearing? All those in favor of closing the public hearing, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to close the public hearing passes 5-0. Commissioner Neal?
I recommend to send proposal ZA3604 to the Board of Commissioners for approval with the following conditions. Number one, no access shall be granted for the proposed commercial horse stable to enter from Riley Road. The only access for the commercial horse stable will be from Concord Road. Access from Riley Road shall be limited to property owner and or tenants, residential use only. Number two, all required state and local licenses must be obtained and maintained in good standing, including with the Georgia Department of Agriculture. Number three, all horses on the property must be maintained in accordance with applicable state and local laws. Number four, a 25-foot planted buffer per Forsyth County standards will be maintained south and east of and along the portion of the respective boundaries of tax parcel 164-015, which is currently owned by Tim and Sonia Bush. Number five, on the northern side of the buffer referenced in zoning condition number four above, a continuous, uniform, 6-foot-high wooden privacy fence shall be installed and maintained by the owner or tenant of the property. The fence shall be stained or painted in earth tone color. The owner's/tenant's obligation to maintain the fence will not prevent it from receiving contribution for maintenance from damage caused by animals or persons on the adjoining property. Number six, an agricultural type fence barrier, for example, barbed wire, must be maintained parallel to the eastern boundary of tax parcel 164-015, currently owned by Tim and Sonia Bush, to prevent equine contact. Number seven, hours of operation for commercial riding shall be limited to daylight hours. Number eight, street lighting for non-residential uses shall be designed as to minimize light spillage along the exterior of the property, not more than 1 foot candle along any residential or agricultural property line, and 2 foot candles at any public street right-of-way, commercial, or industrial property line. And I'll reiterate at the beginning of that, if I said street lighting, it was intended to say lighting. Number nine, no compost or manure shall be allowed to accumulate in such a way that it becomes a nuisance, visual, odor, or health to any adjoining property owner. Number 10, all commercial signage will be located at the Concord Road entrance. And number 11, a limit on the number of horses on the site to be 1 per acre. And let's see.
Yes, I did.
Well, that would, I guess, with the, those conditions, that would be accepting the, that would include the variance with the exceptions that was noted in the conditions.
Is there a second? Motion dies for lack of a second.
I make a motion that we didn't recommend to the Board of Commissioners a denial of
Motion fails 3-2.
I make a motion to postpone to our next public meeting.
Is there a second?
A second.
We have a motion and a second to postpone ZA 3604. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of the motion to postpone ZA 3604, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to postpone ZA 3604 to the next public meeting passes 5-0.
From single family residential R1 to commercial business district CBD 0.734 acres to be combined with a commercial parcel to the east for retail and office for 10,500 square feet of retail space with 42 parking spaces. This property is located at 1831 Canton Highway, Cumming, Georgia. Staff is supportive.
Thank you. I make a motion to open a public hearing on ZA 3626, Linda and Carolyn Craven. May I have a second?
Second.
Second by Commissioner Neal. Is there any discussion about opening the public hearing? All those in favor of opening the public hearing, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to open the public hearing passes 5-0. Is there anyone who'd like to speak in favor of ZA3626, Linda and Harold Gravett?
Madam Chair, members of the Planning Commission, I'm Josh Scott, with Wilson Johnson here on behalf of Linda and Harold Gravett. As Ms. Bernstein said, we're asking for a rezoning of a small parcel to CBD. It has commercial zoning on both sides, but an existing warehouse type use to the west. And the staff is supportive of this. It does comply with the comprehensive plan and the future development map. And with that, I'm happy to answer any questions that you have.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who'd like to speak in favor? Is there anyone who would like to speak in opposition? A motion to close the public hearing of ZA3626, Linda and Harold Gravett. May I have a second?
Second.
Mr. Iglesias, Commissioner Iglesias, may I have the second? Is there any discussion about closing the public hearing? All in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion to close the public hearing passes 5-0. This is District 1. Make a motion to send ZA3626, Linda and Harold Gravett, to the Board of Commissioners with a recommendation of approval with staff conditions as shown on the staff report in our Planning Commission books, with the modification to engineering condition number one so that it reads developer shall reserve right of way of 60 feet from the center line of State Road 20 Canton Highway, and the following conditions. Number one, exposed neon fluorescent lighting is not permitted except for open and closed signs. Lighting shall not blink, flash, or oscillate. Number three, detention basins shall be designed so slopes and bottoms can be easily maintained and extensively landscaped. Number four, a monument sign shall be used at the entrance driveway off of Canton Highway and shall match the principal building materials. There shall be no outside storage facility permitted on the subject property. All garbage dumpsters shall be screened on three sides of said dumpster area with a minimum 6 foot high solid wooden fence or a wall constructed of materials substantially similar in appearance to the building on site that complies with the architectural requirements of the UDC regulations. The fourth side shall be gated and the gate shall be architecturally finished. Garbage dumpster pickup shall be between 6 a.m. and 9 p.m. Monday through Saturday. No garbage pickup on Sunday. Hours of operation will be no earlier than 6 a.m. and no later than 11 p.m. Sunday through Thursday, and 6 a.m. and 12 a.m. Friday and Saturday. No chain link fencing may be used except around detention structures which may have a black or green vinyl coated chain link fence. Rooftop equipment such as HVAC units shall be fully screened. Screening shall be of material that serves as soundproofing to minimize noise trespass. Facade shall be of low reflectance, subtle, neutral, or earth tone colors. The use of high intensity colors, primary colors, metallic colors, black or fluorescent colors is prohibited. The building shall be comprised of brick, stone, and glass with a maximum of 15% accent material, which may include stucco, exterior insulating finish system, EIFS, painted dimensioned wood or cement-based material such as hardy plank. All exterior painted surfaces shall be painted in neutrals and earth tones. Neutrals refer to blacks, whites, beiges, or grays, while earth tones refer to browns, umbers, and sienna, terracotta, and brick tones. Burglar bars, fiberglass awnings, and steel roll-down curtains are prohibited except at the structure's rear. The following uses shall not be permitted on subject property. convenience stores with or without gasoline pumps, gas stations, bars, lounges, nightclubs, provided this shall not preclude a restaurant such as but not limited to Applebee's from having a bar, 24-hour businesses, hotels or motels, theaters, electronic games playing centers, adult novelty stores, adult entertainment centers, pool halls, pawn shops, tattoo parlors, massage parlors, pain clinics, auto repair shop, auto oil change shop, outside construction hours, 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. Monday through Saturday, 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. on Saturday, and none on Sunday. That is my motion. May I have a second?
Second
by Commissioner Iglesias. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion passes 5-0. Next is Mike and Liz Sosby, DA 3627.
Request to rezone from single family residential R1 to commercial business district, CBD, with a conditional use permit for open air business and open storage yard on 2.127 acres with 2,300 square feet of total building area and four parking spaces. A variance to the sewer distance requirement of 5,000 feet to facilitate an on-site septic system per UDC Chapter 18-5.18. This property is located in the southwest corner of Atlanta Highway and Shirley Industrial Way. Staff is supportive.
I make a motion to open the public hearing on DA 3627, Mike and Liz Sosby. May I have a second?
Second.
Commissioner Nolan, we have the second. Is there any discussion on opening the public hearing? All those in favor of opening the public hearing, please signify by raising your hand. All those opposed, please signify by raising your hand. Motion to open the public hearing passes 5-0. Is there anyone who wishes to speak in favor of CA 3627, Mike and Liz Sosby?
Ethan Underwood on behalf of Mike and Liz Sosby. We are requesting a commercial zoning for a piece of property that is literally surrounded by a sea of commercial. We're asking for an open air business. The applicants want to continue to operate a firewood lot. They have owned this property for generations, at least since the late 60s. It's been in the family. And it's been sold off from different users. But now this is the last remaining tract. It's still zoned R1 on Highway 9 right across from Nebraska and Kroger. So we're requesting a variance to allow, or not a variance, but a conditional use permit for the open store. As I said, this is an island in the sea of commercial. It's the last remaining parcel. You can see it, R1. There's a recycling plant, which is fairly into used behind it. And you have a Kroger and a Walmart across the street from it. So it certainly fits and performs. This is the site plan. This will actually make the area more attractive. It will conform to the new overlay requirements as far as landscaping and fencing. That might be installed, and you'll have the displays of the cords of firewood on the edges on the perimeter. So one of the issues that was brought up at the public participation meeting was safety. There is access on Highway 9 right now. That's going to be closed off. The access will come off Shirley Industrial Way. That'll be a safer access for folks make the engineering department on that. So with that, Mike Sosby is here. We're happy to answer your questions.
Thank you.
Is
there anyone else who would like to speak in favor? Is there anyone who would like to speak in opposition? Make a motion to close the public hearing. ZA 3627, Mike and Liz Sosby. May I have a second?
Second.
May Commissioner Nolan go to that second. Is there any discussion on closing the public hearing? All those in favor of closing the public hearing, please signify by raising your hand. All those opposed, motion to close the public hearing passes 5-0. Commissioner Nolan, this is District 10.
Madam Chair, I make a recommendation that we pass CA 3627 on the Board of Commissioners for approval with stated engineering conditions.
I'll second that. Is there any discussion? All those in favor of Commissioner Nolan's motion, please signify by raising your hand. All those opposed, please signify by raising your hand. Motion passes 5-0. The Providence Group of Georgia LLC, ZA 3628.
Due to changes made in the application, staff recommends that it go through an additional zoning review meeting.
All right, do we need to vote on that, or is that just a done deal?
The applicant wishes that it go back through the planning department as well.
May I have a motion for adjournment?
So moved.
Second. Is there any discussion about adjournment? All those in favor of adjourning the meeting signify by raising your hand. All those opposed, please signify by raising your hand. Motion passes to adjourn 5-0 at 8:19.
Thank you.